In science, we teach children to use their senses to collect data about the world around them. This data helps them understand their surroundings, the what, the how, and the why. But when one or more of these senses is missing, how can we ensure positive and productive science learning environments? My research focuses on how deaf and hard of hearing, or DHH, children learn science. Auditory impairment is a low incidence disability. 2 to 3 children out of every 1,000 are born with hearing loss in one or both ears. And this can be complicated by a variety of factors. For instance, more than 90% of deaf children are born to hearing parents, and nearly 3/4 of those parents never learn to sign. In recent years, many families have chosen to pursue cochlear implants for their child rather than learn sign. However, even if the surgery is successful, extensive training is needed for the child to comprehend sounds, and sometimes this training is not completed. Ultimately, this lack of communication between parents and children can lead to delayed language acquisition, reading difficulties, and enduring misconceptions. I interviewed a teacher whose student was profoundly deaf. She made progress quickly, learning to sign, learning how to speak English, and read lips. But as she got older, she realized that she couldn't understand the texts her mother sent her or read the subtitles on the television in her home. Her parents only spoke Spanish. This child, and others like her, who lack a shared language in the home, are less likely to be read to, experience science community resources like zoos or museums, watch science-related programming, or have science-related discussions with their parents. In addition, science curricula for these students is sparse, and support specifically geared towards their science language acquisition is nearly non-existent. These delays tend to compound as children progress in school. Standardized science test scores for children with an auditory impairment are well below the national average, and they fail at a rate nearly 50 percentage points higher than their hearing peers. Members of the deaf community are deeply underrepresented in science careers, in part due to the fact that only 1/4 of deaf students entering post-secondary schools graduate. As such, we're missing out on the perspectives of a whole population. As a teacher educator, I wholeheartedly believe that the transformative power of an effective teacher cannot be understated, but ensuring this effectiveness can be challenging. Many educators of deaf and hard of hearing children, or deaf educators, are prepared through special education programs with limited science content or methods requirements. In the US, there is a shortage of teachers who are adequately prepared to teach these students, and even fewer who are adequately prepared to teach science to them. When these teachers enter the classroom and begin working with deaf and hard of hearing children, their lack of science-specific training quickly becomes apparent. I interviewed deaf educators who had been teaching for years, and while they were generally confident in their skills, they expressed deep insecurities when it came to teaching science. They talk about being terrified of the subject, about not understanding it, or feeling as though they could not have been placed in a worse content area. While themes of hands-on learning were prevalent in their classrooms, few activities were inquiry-based, and most tended to fall into the realm of arts and crafts. The most common teaching strategy was based around repetition. As one teacher said, I pre-teach, reteach, reteach again, and then assess. And the most common accommodation for their students was adding visuals to their PowerPoint lectures. While this may be helpful for some, it can also seriously increase the cognitive load placed on students who are already expected to watch the interpreter using sign at the front of the classroom. So what has this taught us? Deaf and hard of hearing children face complex challenges in public schools, particularly in science. However, while some of these challenges are unique to DHH children, many of the issues they face, like delayed language skills, enduring science misconceptions, and lack of access to community science resources, are common among multiple populations, including English learners, children with special needs, and children from urban contexts. There is much work to be done, and what may be a solution to one school may not be to another. However, understanding how best to meet the needs of those who need the most support will benefit everyone. Accepting poor performance under increased standardization is not the key. Rather, creativity, innovation, and a stronger focus on the individual will lead to progress. Listening to those whose voices are quiet is a good place to start. Thank you.